yo, I gotta get some chalk stuff like LeBron James. That way, before each video, I can go, psh, what is happening? What is going on? My name is GSLING. I'm doing my thing, and I hope you are too. And today, it's Mock Monday, and I've heard some rumors. I've heard some things. I've seen like 20 million mock drafts. For some reason, I think there's something that happened. We'll have to find out. But first off, we gotta change the channel and get into it. It's Mock Monday. Beep. And here we are, it's Mock Monday now. So we got the remote, we got the channel, we got the station. It's time to begin Mock Monday, the excitement building on as we see. Let's see what's gonna happen today at Mock Monday. So first off, the commissioner for the day. You see the fire, you hear the roar, you know who it is. It's Godzilla, and I am so excited. We got two more days until that movie comes out. Oh man, it's gonna be crazy. I thought about moving to Australia here or wherever it came out, just because I think it came out in Australia like the 25th or 26th. Anyway, I don't know if I did. I just didn't feel like I'm moving that far and whatnot just to see a movie, but I was thinking about it. Anyway, we had to have, you know, we have to have a commissioner and everything. But as I keep bringing the suspense on, let's get into the draft. And hold on, let me impersonate Roger Goodell as he's coming out to the podium for the first pick. He gets his blindfold, and here's his draft card. With the first pick in the 2021 NFL Draft, the Jacksonville Jaguars are selecting Trevor Lawrence. Oh, I was right. I knew it. Anyway, let's get the card out of the way. I'm getting that out of the way as I just hit my wall. Wow, I just hit my wall. Anyway, Trevor Lawrence is going to be the pick here for the Jacksonville Jaguars. No surpriser. And you know what? He probably needs to go ahead and get his blindfold back for the second pick in his note card, because we already know who the second overall pick is going to be. It's going to be Zach Wilson. And I know it's like, you know, there's no guarantees with this one, but I think it's almost guaranteed. You know, like when you go to buy a car and whatnot, like, you go out, you research everything, you look at the make and the model, and you get a good idea of what you want, and you know, you see all the reviews and all that crazy stuff. And then when you actually get to the dealership, you see the car and the test drive, right? The test drive's the pro day. Once you get that test drive, you're like, I like this a lot. This is gonna be the car. This is that final decision. That's the when you make that pop, that bang, you know what I'm saying? And that's what the Jets did here with Zach Wilson at his pro day. So I don't know if that makes any sense, but we're comparing Zach Wilson to cars and buying a car, and he is going to be the new object, new car for the New York Jets. Let's go on now to the third pick, which, oh my goodness, as we all have known, the pick here, the trade has happened, and we are finally seeing some craziness go on, and it's probably just the beginning. It is going to be Justin Fields, the pick here at number 3 overall, and here's what I'm thinking. So, isn't it funny? Bill Belichick comes on and says, dude, this Justin Fields kid is crazy. And then, you know, they come out and John Lynch's like, oh, I got to come up and trade for him now. And Kyle Shanahan, they're like, yo, we got to get our guy, Justin Fields. And everyone's saying, well, they haven't had his pro day yet. I'm not worried about the pro day. You don't make your decision off of pro day. I think Justin Fields is going to be the pick here. I mean, I don't know. It could be any one of those three quarterbacks. I doubt it's Mac Jones. I'd be shocked if it's Mac Jones, even though Chris Sims seems to think it's Mac Jones, but I don't know about that. Anyway, we'll have to wait and see. But anyway, Justin Fields is going to be the selection here for the San Francisco 49ers, trading up, giving up 2 first rounders, a third. They give quite a bit, but yeah, you know, they're going to get their quarterback here, Justin Fields. Let's go on now to the next pick here, and the Atlanta Falcons are on the clock, and they are going with the big bad Hulk, Penei Sewell, on the board, and he is now off the board as they take him to protect Matt Ryan's blind side. You can move Jake Matthews to right tackle. You can move Caleb McGarry inside the guard. You can do whatever you want. You can move Penei inside for guard for the first year. I don't know. You can have a lot of opportunity, but this is just too good of an opportunity for the Atlanta Falcons to get a great left tackle for the future for the next 15 years, and the Hulk will hold it down. On now to the Cincinnati Bengals, and the Bengals are going with Kyle Pitts, the bad man, the big dude, the mismatch problem that is being now compared to Tyreek Hill and Calvin Johnson. I heard an article saying that, which is interesting, but he is a mismatch, and he is a total You know, I'm trying to think of the word to describe the words to describe Kyle Pitts. I'm not really sure what people have been calling him, but he's something. But he's Kyle Pitts, and he is going to be the pick here for Cincinnati. And you know, they're thinking, well, you know, we could get Ja'Marr Chase, but I feel like they've already got that. You know, like that sort of player on this roster. I mean, Ja'Marr Chase is different than T. Higgins and whatnot, but if anything, they need to add a different sort of playmaker here, and I think Kyle Pitts makes more sense from a schematics standpoint. On to the Miami Dolphins, who traded in front of the Detroit Lions, which tells me that they want to get a receiver and they want Ja'Marr Chase. And I think the Detroit Lions would say that, you know, is the one way they wouldn't go defense with their first selection. So Miami going to make Detroit and their, you know, whole thing of getting Ja'Marr Chase not happen anymore. And it's Ja'Marr Chase here at number 6. So I think it's just going to be one of those things like, why would they trade back up? I think that they have their eyes set on Ja'Marr Chase and they feel that they can get him at 6. Or maybe it's Kyle Pitts. I don't know. We'll have to wait and see. But obviously, who knows what's going to happen here. But I think, you know, this is what we're going with. Let's go on to our next pick here. And the Detroit Lions are going to be going with Patrick Surtain, a corner from Alabama, and they need a corner because you look at that roster, they have two on their roster. Between Amari Uga and Jeffrey Okuda, it's just not good. So you know what? We're going to go get Patrick Surtain, and he is going to be the man. And now let's go on to the Carolina Panthers, who are going to be taking a quarterback themselves, and they are going to be sticking here and taking Trey Lance at number 8, which hopefully will be great because they need a quarterback, for goodness sake. And it's going to be Trey Lance. They figure on, hey, it's time. We need to go ahead and get a quarterback. He can sit behind Teddy Bridgewater for a year or do something of that nature. On to number 9, which there's being a phone call. We got to get the phone. Joe Douglas has made a trade. And the Denver Broncos have called and said, hey, we want Sam Darnold. We want some competition for Drew Lock. So they bring in some competition and they get Sam Darnold and they swap picks and they do the swaparoo. Actually, this makes a lot of sense in my opinion. I would love to see it because I think that it would be a good beneficial. Look, so you move, what is that? I can't count. I can't do math. What is 13, 14 picks? You move 14 picks and you get Sam Darnold, and that's not much to really give up. You know what I mean? Like 14 picks, if you're wrong, you're wrong. If it's Darnold's not the guy, he's not the guy, but he bring in more competition. I don't think they're going to draft a quarterback. I think if anything, they're going to be looking for some sort of option, whether it's, you know, out in free agency still, maybe Mitchell Trubisky, who knows, but you know, we'll have to wait and see. But I think this would be make a lot of sense for the Denver Broncos. You move back 14 spots, you don't give up any picks, and you're still keeping everything, you know, you don't change anything. Maybe it's a comp pick next year or something like that. Maybe it's a fourth rounder, and if he plays all 17 games, it turns into a third rounder, something like that. So without further ado, let's get into the pick. And with the 9th overall pick, the New York Jets are going with K. Woody Pay, which, man, I would love to see this. Maybe it's a little bit of a biased pick here, but I want to see this so, so bad. Like, if you're talking about the San Francisco 49er wide 9 bringing it to New York, K. Woody Pay is the definition of this. I know you got Carl Lawson, but you pair him with K. Woody Pay, more of a base 4-3 end on the opposite side, and this wide 9 defense rushing the passer. You got two studs on the outside. You got Quentin Williams on the inside. You also bring in Sheldon Rankin. Dude, this defense is bad. I would be insane as a Jets fan. Obviously, we're getting pumped up here. I want to see it so, so bad. We would actually have something elite again on defense. But K. Woody Pay here, I'm hoping that this happens. On to the pick number 10 here. And Dallas Cowboys, they got to improve their interior defensive line. It's a huge need. I know people go out there and say corner, 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 corner. And I'm still going to be hearing it. I know it. But I think that they have to go interior defensive line as of right now. And we'll see if they bring on Jaron Reed or who knows, right? We'll have to wait and see if they make some more moves and stuff. The free agency's not over yet. But Christian Barmore makes too much sense to me here. They need a good interior defensive lineman. They, you know, their defense all of a sudden has not been good ever since they've lost, you know, some of that. And, you know, since they've lost their interior players and just haven't been, you know, on the same page with, you know, defense and things like that. Rod Marinelli, of course, was huge. But, you know, things have changed. They need to improve that interior defensive line. They go ahead and do it here with Christian Barmore. On to number 11. And also, I want to say this. Let's go back. Let's rewind. Rewind my words. Christian Barmore, if you had to compare him to last year, I would say he's not as good as Derrick Brown, but I would say he's right there with Javon Kinlaw, maybe even better than Javon Kinlaw of a prospect. So, and Javon Kinlaw and, you know, Derrick Brown, they both went, you know, in that, you know, 8 to 12 range, right? Or something, you know, more around there. So, you know, I think this is makes a lot of sense for Barmore. So I actually think that Barmore is going to go a lot higher than people think. Let's go on now to, and you may have seen this already, but it's Micah Parsons here for the New York Football Giants, and they need a versatile linebacker. They need some peace next to Blake Martinez. I know you got Tate Crowder, but we'll have to wait and see. He's more of a depth piece, I think, as a rotational linebacker. I think that you need to upgrade the unit. I could see them going offensive line here. I think it's between linebacker, offensive line, and maybe edge, but I think they'll look at edge a little bit later just in terms of what this team values. But we'll have to wait and see who is on the board and all that good jazz. But let's go on now to the Philadelphia Eagles, who are going to be taking a receiver. They move back, which tells me, you know, they could be in the corner market too. I think this is between corner and receiver for them. But I'm going with Jaylen Waddle here at number 12, which they need to get another good receiver in here. And now they have electric speed with Jalen Reagor and Jaylen Waddle. Now you got Travis Fulcombe and Greg Ward. So, you know, you got a good combination of receivers and everything. But man, that would be an electric outside for the Philadelphia Eagles for Jalen Hurts to be thrown to, which they, you know, they've given him at least a year to see what they have with him. So let's go on now to the LA Chargers, and no surprise, you got to go ahead and get that left tackle. Trey Pipkins is not going to probably be the starter, and I said that not probably. That's not really a very good way to, but you know what? It's going to be Rashawn Slater here, going to be their left tackle for the future. And we go from there. Oh, also, did you know it's National Nevada Day? You know, they have a National Nevada Day, sorry. And yeah, I didn't even know that. But anyway, kind of crazy. I just found that out today. So I'm like, ooh, that's pretty cool. All right, so let's go ahead and go on to the Minnesota Vikings here. And the Minnesota Vikings at pick number 14 are going to be going Jalen Phillips. I understand the whole concussion concerns and whatnot, but he's my top edge on the board. Him and Kay Woody Pay are right there. I think they're neck and neck, but in terms of pure pass rusher, I think Jalen Phillips is the best player in this draft for that. I would even say he's a top 10 pick if it weren't for the concussion things. This dude is a monster. We'll have to see, wait and see how the pro day goes, but should be going on right now. But anyway, I love Jalen Phillips. He's my favorite edge rusher in this class with, like I said, with Kay Woody Pay. I think those two are neck and neck. But go on to a trade that has just happened. Bill Belichick, he surprises everybody. You never know what Bill's about to do. He's going to do something crazy. I know it. I can see it. I understand, but I know what he's doing. He's trying to fake everybody out. So what he's going to be doing, he's going to be trading back. He's like, ha, ha, ha. They think I'm trading up for a quarterback. Actually, he might trade up for a quarterback. It just depends if they can work out a deal. I still think they might, but in this mock draft, we don't know what Bill Belichick's going to do. He's either going to trade up or he's going to trade down. He's going to trade down in this one. He's going to get an extra third rounder and some change or whatever from the Tennessee Titans, who see a guy named Devontae Smith, number 6 from Alabama, on the board, and they need a receiver to pair along with Corey Davis, and they get their guy. So let's go ahead and talk about the Arizona Cardinals, who need a corner. So J.C. Horn is on the board, and they go ahead and snag up J.C. Horn. Sound the horn. Sound the alarm. It's J.C. Horn. He is done. He is gone here to the Arizona Cardinals. Desperate need of some lockdown corner, and they get their man. On to the Vegas Raiders. They see Christian Darrisaw here on the board at 17, and they've got to get him. They need offensive line desperately. Darrisaw can play at right tackle, and you slide him in over there. It needs a desperate need. I know they're high on Andre James. Maybe he'll be their center and whatnot. I have no idea what the Raiders are going to do, to be honest with you. But they go ahead and snag up Darrisaw to improve their offensive line and get a good tackle group, at least with Colton Miller and Christian Darrisaw. On to the Miami Dolphins are back on the clock. And Jason Oway ran a 4.3. This dude's nuts. And even if you tack on a little bit of time, he's still a 4.4 guy. He's nuts, man. I'm telling you. He is insane. I think he is going to go. He's going in the first round, period. He's going. I would be shocked if he does not go in the first round. I think he could even go as high as, you know, like that 15 to 20. I think he's going to go between 15 and 25-ish. Maybe 26 to the Browns at latest. Because I know Montez Sweat went 26, actually, to the Cleveland Browns. Or, sorry, to the Washington football team. But Jason Oway, in my opinion, he is not slipping out of the first round. He is going to be a top 25 sort of dude. And the Miami Dolphins go ahead and race that in for, you know, just taking a chance on an elite linebacker edge duo, you know, what they can bring in. They need someone on that edge, and they get him with Jason Oway. That dude is going to be insane, man. I'm telling you. He might take a year or two, but he could be the best edge rusher in 3 to 4 seasons. On to the Washington football team. And this might be a surpriser. You're probably like, Walker Little? Walker Little? Yeah, Walker Little is going to be the pick here at number 19 for the Washington football team. And my thinking behind this is Walker Little can be a guy who can develop behind Cornelius Lucas for a year or whatever. Again, Lucas may not even play the entire season. We'll have to wait and see. You know, you could let Walker Little go in, you know, sit on the bench for half the season and work him into the starting lineup. And they need a guy like this who can be their franchise left tackle. I think Walker Little absolutely is worth a top 20 pick. I mean, that's my opinion. I think he's worth a top 25 pick for sure. I would do it if I need an offensive line. And Washington has a good team. The Washington football team, it is a good team. And I think that getting Walker Little here for the future is kind of the way that they should be looking at here to improve that offensive line, which they do need at least some depth to on that offensive line, because it's just they don't have a whole ton of depth. So we go ahead and get Walker Little to have for the long term here. Now let's go on to the Chicago Bears. And they're not trading back. They're just going to take Mac Jones at 20 here. And I think that this is a team that I think they're trying to keep it low with saying, oh, Andy Dalton's our quarterback. I don't think he's going to be their quarterback. I think that they will either trade up or take Mac Jones or, you know, take Kellen Mond later. I think they're going to do something, though. Like, that, you know, advertising Andy Dalton is basically saying that they're, you know, Matt Nagy and Ryan Pace are getting fired this offseason, you know, this next season. So I think they're going to make a move somehow, some way. I'd be shocked. Anyway, Mac Jones is the pick here for the Chicago Bears. On to the Indianapolis Colts, who are going to be taking Dylan Raidens, the tackle from North Dakota State. He is going to come over here and protect, you know, Carson Wentz because, you know, hey, we need left tackle. I think Raidens can slide right into their two left tackle. And, you know, why is Tevin Jenkins getting passed up here? Well, you know, he's right tackle, and it's not that easy to move people from right tackle to left tackle in that sort of situation. So I'm just saying Raidens is, you know, left tackle. You put him right in here. I think the Colts would not pass up on Dylan Raidens here on their offensive line. On to number 22 with the New England Patriots. And wow, Bill Belichick pulling off some more moves here. He is going out and getting Caleb Farley at 22. This is a good risk reward. You figure on Stephon Gilmore may not be a Patriot after this next season. We'll have to wait and see how things work. And even if he is, the New England Patriots love to get corners. They value the secondary. And you get Caleb Farley, potentially a true lockdown corner. You get him here at 22. Great value. Obviously, the back thing is interesting. I think he's definitely going to, as I'm knocking things over, it scared me. You probably see my face. I should rewind that. You're probably going to tape that up. Anyway, Caleb Farley is going to be the pick here for the New England Patriots, and they go ahead and improve that secondary for the long run. They can sit this guy, too. Like, they don't need him week one. They've got a pretty complete roster, obviously. So you can sit Caleb Farley for, you know, half the season or even the entire season if they need to. And he's going to be a guy that can come in, you know, next season and be a baller for him. So I think that that would be crazy for the New England Patriots if they're not going quarterback in the first round, which we look at all options here. Maybe they look at Kellen Mond with an, you know, in the second round. It's possible. I think they will go quarterback 100%, but you know, it could be Kellen Mond. It could be someone else that we don't know of that New England has got their eyes on. They're tricky, man. Bill Belichick's tricky. On, yeah, trust me, I know New England. Anyway, crazy. Let's go on to the Broncos pick here, and it's going to be JOK, Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah. This is one of those where it's like, hey, you go ahead and get that versatile linebacker. I know everyone, it's Vic Fangio. He loves his versatile linebackers, and you know what? I'm going on that trend too. I don't know, man. It's a tough one. I was thinking about giving them to Washington, but here's my reasoning too behind not giving him to Washington. I don't think he fits into the Washington sort of mold right now. They've got tons of safeties, and I think JOK is more of a safety prospect or a hybrid linebacker slash safety dude. Like, you want to get him in the slot and whatnot. I think Washington already kind of has that, so it doesn't really fit the mold. I think the Broncos here could really use a guy like that, you know, as kind of that hybrid safety linebacker duo. I don't know. Anyway, that's kind of the way I'm looking at it here. It's tough to say. Anyway, JOK is going to be okay there. Let's go on to the Pittsburgh Steelers, and they're going to be taking Travis Etienne. They need a running back. They go ahead and snag their running back here in the first round. Get Ben Roethlisberger, an elite playmaker outside of the backfield. They'll figure out their offensive line. They just always do. And they get Travis Etienne at 24. On to 25 now. And Javion Holland, the first safety, is off the board. I think safeties are going to go higher maybe than people think. I might not be surprised if a safety goes before this. Like, even like in the early 20s, maybe even the teens. I think it's very popular. It's a really good safety class. Like it's a really, I think it's an underrated safety class. But Javion Holland going to be the first safety off the board. He can play free safety. He can play slot. He can play strong. He can play across the board with Urban Meyer here looking for some versatile pieces in the secondary. Already getting Rashawn Jenkins. You go ahead and add Javon Holland to this defense. On to number 26, and it's going to be Azeez Ojulari, the edge rusher from Georgia. And here's what I'm thinking with this one. I would love to see Myles Garrett and Azeez. You got the speed, you got the power, and you just say, hey, Myles going to eat over here. You got Azeez just coming around right tackles, you know, with his speed. It's an insane combination. You get a Washington sort of vibe with a Montez Sweat and a Chase Young sort of vibes here with what they have. Now, Jason Owe would be insane. If Jason Owe falls here, I'm definitely racing that in too for the Cleveland Browns. But Azeez Ojulari would be really, really good too here as well. All right, so we're here for the Baltimore Ravens now, and the Baltimore Ravens are going to be taking Gregory Rousseau. Now, it's really tough to really think about where Greg is going to be going. But he probably will go earlier than this just because of the tools he has. He's another one that we'll just have to wait and see how the pro day goes. But Gregory Rousseau here at 27. He's going to be this long arm dude, pocket pusher sort of dude. I don't know. Baltimore Ravens, they need another pass rusher here to get into this defense. They go and snag Greg Rousseau, and he can be this elite defensive end dude that they can have. For the long term here, they definitely need some help on the defensive line. On to number 28, and Greg Newsome is going to be the pick here. I don't know what's going on. Marshawn Lattimore now with the gun charge and everything. And he's got the gun in the glove box now. I don't know what's going on. Anyway, going to ask Botch and Lombardi on that one. Anyway, Greg Newsome is, shout out to Botch Lombardi. He's always got the funniest stuff. But Greg Newsome here is going to be the pick for the New Orleans Saints. Go ahead and get their corner. Even with Marshawn Lattimore, they need some more help in that secondary. On to the next pick here, 29, and Elijah Vera Tucker going to be that guy. And you figure Elgton Jenkins can go into center. You can put Elijah Vera Tucker at guard and, you know, kind of shorten things up. But getting AVT gives them another versatile piece on that offensive line. So, you know, they definitely need to improve that offensive line, you know, losing Corey Linsley. So you figure on, you can move Elgton Jenkins to center. You can figure so many things out. They're going to do it. I know they will. Green Bay is the best at it. They go ahead and solidify that offensive line here with AVT. On to number 30. We're almost done. Oh, no, I don't want to finish. We should do another round here. Hold on. Anyway, the Bills are going to be taking Kelvin Joseph, the corner from Kentucky. Dude, this guy is insane. I love Kelvin Joseph. He's one of my favorite corners in this class. And, man, we'll see what happens. But this team, Buffalo Bills, I think they're going to be trying to play more man coverage. They go ahead and get someone who's really good at man coverage. Kelvin Joseph, he can stick with corners. He's got the elite speed. And, I think if you look at it, why did they lose to the Chiefs? They weren't able to stick. They had to play off so many times. They need corners who can stay with receivers and beat, you know, some of these teams like the Chiefs. On to the Chiefs. Speaking of the Chiefs, we have to go on to them. And they're going to be taking Tevin Jenkins, the offensive tackle from Oklahoma State. And I know you're thinking, how does he fall to 31? I do actually think he might fall in this draft. I don't know. I think he might fall just because towards the back end of the first round. But you know what? If he's here, you absolutely have to take him. And, you know, also with those situations, it's like teams, again, didn't want to move right tackle, left tackle. So this is kind of the way it worked out. And I think that this could be a realistic, you know, possibility on what happens. You never know. It's the draft. Things happen. And we're putting all possibilities. And the Chiefs go ahead and snag Tevin Jenkins air at the back end. And I actually think this is a good value for Tevin Jenkins. I think, well, it's a good value, but I think it's like kind of might worry where, like I said, where he's going to go. On to our final pick. And it's going to be Tyson Campbell. Tyson Campbell, the corner. I know they've got great corners, right? You're like Sean Murphy Bunting. You got Carlton Davis. You got, you know, it's like you got the whole group out there. Jamel Dean. But that's it. I mean, you got those three guys. Besides that, that's like all they have. What if an injury happens? You get Tyson Campbell here. He can play the man press, you know, sort of dude in this Todd Bowles defense. Tyson Campbell could be a monster here. Got elite speed, an elite athlete, and you pair him up on this defense with Todd Bowles. This is the perfect fit, in my opinion, for Tyson Campbell. I think he'd be an absolute monster here. So that is going to round out the draft here, Mock Monday. I hope everyone has a really, really good day and everything. I hope you enjoyed. Let me know what you think, agree or disagree. But without further ado, my name is GSLING. I'm doing my thing, and I hope you do too. And I hope you have a great day, and pa, 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 later.